thank you all for coming to the inaugural session of the 30th NIAS Annual Program for Senior Executives. On behalf of the Director of NIAS, Professor Baldev Raj, and my colleagues and other members of NIAS, I extend all of you a very warm welcome to Bangalore and to NIAS. I'm Sindhu Radhakrishna, one of the coordinators for the course, and the other coordinator is Dr. Chidambaram Iyer, who is also here. Please do let us know if you have any issues with anything to do with the course. We'll try our best to solve everything for you. I do hope you're a most honored guest for the next 1 week, and I do hope you'll enjoy yourselves. I now invite our director, Professor Baldev Raj, to begin the proceedings.
Thank you, Professor Sindhu. Welcome, Dr. R. Chidambaram. Dear participants, my own colleagues, it's wonderful to welcome you. The course which you are attending was started at the very inception of NIAS by G.R.D. Tata and Raja Ramana. They were of the firm conviction that if we can produce leaders, the country would lead. And if we are not able to produce leaders, there is no other way by which the country can address the challenges and grow. It's the 30th course. One always reminisces that when the first course started, G.R.D. Tata and Raja Ramana would spend all the time to be there and discuss with the participants. In fact, one of the participants, Mr. B. Muthuraman, you would hear tomorrow, who came in the first course, and we all know that B. Muthuraman was a very successful corporate leader, and he is going to talk about corporate leadership. When you look at the participants this year, you are delighted. You have almost every aspect of leadership covered in a small group of about 25 participants. Only I wish that we could have more ladies participating, but we have only a few. I believe only 3 ladies are participating, perhaps. But I'm happy that the course is coordinated by a lady, Professor Sindhu Radhakrishnan. And it's extremely important. It's not a bypass line. I believe that gender participation is one of the extremely important aspects of India making an equitable country and India taking balanced decisions on sustainability and various issues which are being addressed by the society. I'm not here to give a talk on leading a change. My main purpose is to welcome, but I would use a few of my minutes to talk about what comes to my mind at the beginning. First of all, NIAS is created to work at challenges, and if you like, to then plan the research and see how various disciplines can be joined together to address those challenges. Challenges can be inequalities, challenges can be culture and heritage, challenges can be education for the gifted, education for those where education doesn't reach, looking at energy and environment, looking at globalization, urbanization, and looking at strategic programs where inputs are based on technologies and strategies. So just to give example of what we do, and then we combine various disciplines with our faculty and doctoral research students to look at those problems in a sustained way. We rarely go for short-term funding. We always look at the mechanisms by which we can have a long-term perspective, because these problems cannot be addressed based on limited outcomes and limited fundings. So that way Tata Trust have been extremely understanding about what NIAS is to do, and then they support us, and the rest of the money we get from various possibilities as we go. I mentioned about the participants. I must also mention about the speakers. If you look at the speakers, they are drawn from justice, economy, sports, music, entertainment, science and technology, healthcare, and so on and so forth. Getting the learning in a field in which you are working is relatively easy. But getting a comprehension of what you need to be a leader of the kind of JRD Tata or Homi Bhabha, I think you have to absorb many aspects and many perspectives, and you have to know the country, and you have to know that how in this ecosystem we can be a leader. I said that I'd mention a few things about the leadership. To me, without the competence in the domain in which you are working, and your capacity and your willingness to carry the burdens with pleasure, and more important, which very rarely is recognized, the universal compassion. I think the biggest resource for a leader is the compassion, universal compassion. I'm yet to see a leader who is not having a very good measure of compassion. In fact, the two speakers which you would listen today, Dr. R. Chidambaram and Dr. Sancheti, they come from different fields, one from nuclear science and technology, other from healthcare. You would see that how they have committed themselves and made them as highly acclaimed leaders to be able to serve the cause of the country and also stand tall to inspire the young people. Sometimes the compassion, competence and capacity is not enough. One must have ambition, preferably to serve the society, not for materialistic purposes, though nothing is wrong in having materialistic ambitions also. One must have the attitudes to do that. Many a times when we grow, I think the human machine, the way it has evolved, it finds excuses very easily. It is very easy to say that I could not achieve what I aspired to do or what was my dreams because of various reasons. I think the leaders really don't recognize that. There are no excuses for leader, and the history is full of people from Ramanujam to Albert Einstein to Hawking to Beethoven. They were challenged in some way. All of these people were challenged in some way. They are different from Jamshedji Tata, Homi Bhabha and all that. But the people which I mentioned, in spite of the severe challenges, they decided that no, they would be the ultimate leaders, they would be the icons. So I think, why for a person like me, there should be an excuse that I am not able to achieve something which I aspire to do and for which I have built the competence over the years. It's also extremely important that we recognize the priorities of the country, high growth, with sustainability, with equity, and I think then everything starts putting in place. The last point which I want to make is that the leader cannot be there unless she is able to attract many, many good young people around. If you are not able to attract young people and make them involved in your commitment, I think it is not possible for you to be a leader. So are you a magnet for the young people, the most competent young people, to be a part of your dream? And I think that is your, whatever you may call, the combination of your characteristics, traits, the personality, which really, and in that, nothing attracts the young people more than the purpose of your work, your own competence, your own compassion, and your own commitment. I must welcome Dr. R. Chidambaram as a first speaker, and I'm delighted Professor Sancheti is here, and they are going to be the two speakers. In fact, the first day starts with two Padam Vibhushans. It's very rare, and two people admirable in their own way. But at this stage, I must introduce Dr. R. Chidambaram. I am not going to introduce him by the biodata, because today Google is a good source for reading all the biodata and accomplishments. One should not take time to introduce a speaker, whatever is written in the Google. Dr. R. Chidambaram, I was very fortunate to come in contact with him when I was young. When he was pursuing science, he was the best among the scientists. He pursued crystallography, high pressure physics. Because of his contributions in physics, he became the group director of physics, then the director of Baba Atomic Research Center at a very young age. Then his work in the high pressure physics led for his leadership role in the nuclear explosions, nuclear experiments of 74 and 1998. He was the chairman of Atomic Energy. He was the chairman of the Board of Governors of International Atomic Energy Agency. And I went many a times to Atomic Energy Agency to pursue my work or to contribute to the programs. And his name always resonated whenever I talked to the director generals or the senior people or the people who are working. They remembered Dr. R. Chidambaram for his contributions. And later on, when IAEA decided to have a panel of eminent persons to look at the renaissance and the changing scenarios of nuclear energy, he was one of the prominent members. More than that, when he became the chairman, he nucleated many programs of vital interest, grew the leadership of nuclear energy in the world. And then as a principal scientific advisor, I think his biggest contribution has been bridging between a young student in a remote area to the rural population, to the Prime Minister, through all of us. And he has a unique capability to recognize the leaders and then make them inspired to do many things. And he has been responsible for national knowledge, grid, then high technologies for the rural folk, and security and whole lot of things you can talk about, climate change and things like that. More important, he is a lovable person. You look forward to the opportunity of meeting him. It's never a sort of a strain on you that you are going to meet a person who is the first in the echelons of the science and technology of the country and maybe one among the very few people in the world at that level. But you love to meet him, you love to share a coffee with him, you love to gossip with him. And yesterday I was seeing cricket with him and laughing and seeing that what are the chances of India going through. We of course wished India to win, but finally India didn't win. I am sure that you are here, you would love the beauty of NIAS. NIAS, we all of us make efforts to see that NIAS looks the most beautiful when you come. This is a flagship program. Even the gardener, Krishna, he sees that the roses blossom at that time, the marigolds are at its best at this time, the nature is at its best so that you enjoy. Our whole administrative team and coordinators do your best. Take a long walk, experience nature. You have very good forest at the back in the ISC campus through which you can walk through. Please don't miss that opportunity. And I am sure that though we have put the iconic speakers, the competence of the group itself arguably is more than the competence of the speakers. So I think you have a lot to learn from each other and become friends for a lifelong, because very rarely you would have such a kind of a diverse group together staying for such a long time and in an environment where you can discuss everything. And at the end, we want you to contribute by saying to us that what you feel as yourself, as your organization, how you can lead the change in this country. And your inputs are extremely valuable, and many a time they help us to mold our programs of research depending upon what you would say that how you want to lead the change, how your organization wants to lead the change. So welcome very much, and I'm sure that you would have delightful experience. And as Professor Sindhu said, that we are all at your command, including me. Please walk into my room anytime and talk to any of us in NIAS, and we'd be happy to see that it is one of the most enjoyable and a sort of a trigger for change in already your comprehensive capability which you have already acquired. May I now request Dr. R. Chidambaram to inaugurate this course.
Dr. Baldev Raj, friends, participants in this in this meeting program, I must thank Dr. Baldev Raj, my old friend, for inviting me to speak here, and also for the kind introduction. See, all of us want India to become a knowledge economy with capability to develop new knowledge and also the ability to appropriate knowledge from all over the world. And for that to happen, you must have high quality leadership, high quality management. And today's India is not the India of 30 years back, 20 years back, 10 years back. It's growing, there's no question about that. The question really is, how do you increase the pace of development to become a developed country? Not enough just become a developed country. Beyond that, to become a knowledge economy. Also, you know, if you look at the discussions that take place today, we also have the ability to look at things very objectively and dispassionately. A couple of weeks back, I released the book of my friend Kiran Doshi. Kiran Doshi, entitled, of course, the vice president was also there, Jinnah Came Often to Our House. This is a book which is on, it's a historic fiction. Historic fiction combined with a romantic tale, something like War and Peace, or like Gone with the Wind, things of that kind. But here, he had looked at the period in the early part of the 20th century, very objectively and dispassionately. It's what enables us to have debates, sometimes ridiculous sounding debates, on issues on our TV media. But then the good thing is that anything we are not afraid to discuss, whether it's intolerance. See, I've never understood the word intolerance. See, when I say I tolerate somebody, I mean I don't like him, but I tolerate him. But our culture is we respect everybody. Something in a completely different plane. Award vapasi. Telling somebody, thank God I know this man. I didn't know this man had got the award in the first place. Now that he is returning it, now I know he had got the award 20 years back. But the important thing is India is changing in a variety of ways. And the young people are impatient. Young people are impatient. They are looking for rapid growth and they are looking for leadership which can bring in this kind of growth that they are looking for. They are looking for India of our dreams. Whether you are old or young, is India which is economically developed, scientifically advanced and militarily strong. You know, I said in the Naidama lectures, I think 99, that national development and national security are two sides of the same coin. Security without development is vulnerable. Development without security is vulnerable. Security without development is, of course, meaningless. What is the point in having? And historically, you have got examples of this. And the greatest advantage of recognized strength is that you don't have to use it. This is actually the principle of nuclear deterrence. We want an India where the human development index is high. The moment is pathetically low. And I've said for a long time, there are only two parameters, unlike the three United Nations uses: per capita electricity consumption, female literacy. India cannot become a developed country unless it is near 100% literate without gender discrimination. And the per capita electricity consumption has to go up 6 to 8 times. That is why all energy options are so important for India. In the report, which 2008 report of IAEA, which Dr. Baldevaraj mentioned, we have said the greatest challenges in the 21st century are going to be climate change and energy security. These are going to be the two major challenges. And we want in India where there is energy security having reached a reasonable level of per capita electricity consumption. don't want to reach like the United Nations. T.D. Lee was saying, president of ICSU, that everybody started living like the Americans, the world will need 5.5 times the resources which, natural resources which the world has. But we don't want to go there, but at least we want the poorest in India, the rural in India. And one of my definitions of a developed India is when the quality of life in rural India becomes comparable to the quality of life in the non-urban areas of already developed countries, then I'll consider India to be a developed country. Because the other kinds of securities, water, food, nutrition, health, but all of them basically depend on energy security. And all this is possible only if India becomes a knowledge economy, knowledge-driven economy. And for this to happen, as I said, we need high-quality leaders and highly competent managers. And it is going to be driven substantially by science and technology. This is what Panditji said, and this is what the present Prime Minister is saying. And we need talented young people. And then there are the gifted. There are people in NIAS who are interested in this, because we have started a program from our office, how to identify and nurture gifted children. The position is, today if there were a Srinivasa Ramanuja among us, he can't pass any entrance exam. Because Srinivasa Ramanuja mathematics average, he failed twice in what we used to call the 11+2 intermediate exam. Once Government Arts College, Kumbakonam, tried again, Pachayapas College. The only man in history after his 11th standard, he got the DSC honoris causa from Cambridge. Nothing in between. That is people who are profoundly gifted, but there are other levels of gifted. We need high quality faculty. We should be able to set up world class facilities and be able to attract high quality scientists and faculty. Of course, there must be money. You can't do things without money. We need a strong infrastructure, including an e-infrastructure. That's what the National Knowledge Network is about. Appetite for risk-taking. You know, you can do a research which is very safe. You are a smart guy. Write a lot of papers without taking risks. And you can guarantee publication in fairly quite leading journals. But we want people who have an appetite for risk-taking. I'll come back to this later. We need international collaboration. We have been having. But this has been when we were invited to give lectures abroad. We felt very good. They called us for a spend some time there and we felt very good. But actually what they were doing, were they were leveraging our intellects to strengthen their own initiatives. I think the time has come for India to do likewise. We should participate, there is no question, we should go there and all that. But we should also leverage international collaboration to strengthen initiatives which should be Indian. If you want to be a leader, a global leader. In fact, we should have leaders. Leaders, I have talked about this excellent RI research and innovation ecosystem. Research is generating new knowledge, innovation, adding value to that knowledge. Economic value, strategic value, or a mix of them. And for which we need leaders. But leaders can create their own ecosystems. C.V. Raman, Homi Bhabha, no, didn't ask for an ecosystem. They created the ecosystem. Because there are great guys like Srinivas Ramanujam, Satyendranath Bose, who don't need an ecosystem. They are soloists. So, you know, we need people of all kinds. Leadership. You know, this is a book by Management and Machiavelli, written by Anthony Jay, 50 years back. And he says, leadership needs wisdom. Of course, wisdom, courage, vision. See, you can't become a leader in any specific field unless you have a deep knowledge. You must also have a lifelong, long experience of the relevant area also helps. See, if you're ignorant about a field, how can you become a leader in that field? And he distinguishes leadership from management. Leadership and management should not be confused. Management requires techniques. He wrote it 50 years back, as I said. Now management techniques have become more and more sophisticated with the advent of computers, databases, electronic connectivity. But leadership cannot be reduced to a system and incorporated into a training manual. Leadership, how much it can be developed, or you must identify the spark and let them grow. Leadership styles, different styles. There are dangerous leaders. Make no mistake, Hitler was a leader. Transformational leaders, Mahatma Gandhi, who are followed because of the ideals they represent and communicate. Scientific leaders like Homi Bhabha, who carry people with them because of their awe-inspiring goals. You see, Arthur Koestler talks of two kinds of people in top positions, what they call the yogi and the kamisa. Yogi is the contemplative thinker. And commissar is the man of action. This is the kind of definition he has used. Of course, if you have a creative leader, he has to be a mixture of both. And a creative leader in science and technology should be given the opportunity to grow from a young age. It so happened that Bhabha was young when he started the Department of Atomic Energy. And he died very, very young. Of course, you can go into history, you have got Adi Shankara, and then of course Srinivas Ramanujam, so many people, Swami Vivekananda, who died very young, 30s. Homi Bhabha was a superb leader, unique mixture of the yogi and the kamisa. See, I almost say he was 100% yogi and 100% kamisa. Mathematically, you know, it's difficult to say that, so I avoided saying that. What a man who did it, and his greatest strength was that he created a leadership swarm around him. Homi Setna, Raja Ramanna, Brahma Prakash, A.S. Rao, so many other next generation. And that was his greatest strength. A leader requires other leaders to be. See, if you are a second-rate guy, you select a third-rate guy. And then the institution goes to dogs. But if you have, you must have the courage even to select people who are better than you in some respects. And that is the essence of leadership. Just because somebody knows better than you in many areas doesn't mean you should make sure that he is suppressed. Bhabha's legacy, of course, persists in full strength in the DAE establishment. Many leaders in atomic energy, Homi Bhabha, you know, I must tell you this about Homi Bhabha. When I was chairman of the Board of Governors of IAEA, I proposed to the board that Bhabha's statue must be kept outside the boardroom. No objection. And the Bhabha's bust is there. And at that time, the bust was only Otto Hahn, was the discoverer of fusion. After that, Khrushchev was a great Russian nuclear leader. Khrushchev, there are other people, Lewis from Canada, who was a friend of Bhabha and that helped in. See, Bhabha was not afraid of international collaboration. He could bring it in. Self-reliance should not mean avoidance of international collaboration. Use their strength. Bhabha did that. Or we got the first fuel for Apsara reactor from England, John Cockcroft, because they were all friends at that time. One of the great leaders was Fermi, Enrico Fermi. And Fermi was one of the, you know, the first reactor, first chain reaction was under the squash court in the University of Chicago, led by Fermi, Italian. Between them, Hitler and Mussolini handed on a platter some of the greatest scientists of that time to the United States. That thing is not going to happen. It's such a stupid thing to do. Such great scientists, all of them who led American science during those period were all come away, who run away from Germany and to a lesser extent from Italy. What Fermi did was he went to receive his Nobel Prize and didn't come back. He went with his wife and from there he went away to the United States, didn't come back to come back to Italy. A lot of jokes about Fermi. I was talking to the director of the Argonne National Lab, Peter Littlewood, and I told him this story. And one of the stories, this story is that Fermi was the only man who had measured the neutron cross-sections of a number of elements. And at that time, when they were building, for example, this plutonium-producing reactor at Hanford, they didn't know the cross-section of many elements, many isotopes. So they said the method was to go and stand near Fermi and tell him some absurd figure for the neutron cross-section, as he says. This is written by a student of Fermi, James Cronin. And then he says, Fermi will get very agitated. So you go on changing the cross-section numbers until a point will be reached, Fermi will say, chalo, most likely that was the correct. This is what is this Fermi's intuition. You know, there was a famous futurologist called Alvin Toffler. And he said many years back, he said, yesterday violence was power. Today wealth is power. And tomorrow knowledge will be power. Obviously today everybody knows knowledge is power. It was written a long time back. An equally long time back, I paraphrased Alvin Toffler to say, what is the basis of all this? Why was violence power? Anybody who had the best technology to execute violence was powerful. It happened to us, they came on horses, we fought on elephants, which got in the olden days. And then, of course, right up to nuclear weapons. Wealth is power, of course, you have the best technology. Industrial revolutions based on technologies to create power. And that is where we got left behind. We are trying to catch up now. And knowledge. Today, whatever knowledge, new technologies which develop, they are the guys, all the Facebook guys and the Google guys and this guy and that guy with new technology. So I had paraphrased Alvin Toffler to say, technology is power. And this will continue in the foreseeable future. I don't see this changing. And for that is why countries and companies, if they want to dominate, they use two mechanisms. Intellectual property rights, technology control regimes. If it is a commercial technology, they make sure put in this IPR. And then when it is strategic technology, use this technology control regime. And today, if you want to play the game, you have to do likewise. You can't say, change the rules of the game. Rules of the game will not going to change. So, what we should be doing is to develop more and more IPR. Of course, you can have altruistic collaboration. Altruistic collaborative innovation is also important. Happened in the case of the World Wide Web. WWW were developed by CERN. And they didn't charge any money for it. If today somebody has a solution to the problems caused by climate change or for pandemic diseases, surely one should not look for IPR and wait for Dr. Sancheti. Make it available freely for that. See, this is where it comes. Our leadership we're looking for must be such that we prevent technology domination by others. This starts at the core of the whole thing. Firstly, we must develop technological self-confidence with appetite for risk-taking. If you don't take risks, you can never be the first in the... If you want to play safe all the time, you should hang on to the coattails of the front runner so that he will, of course, win the race. That you can't help. But then if there is anything on the way, he will avoid, you also avoid the pitfalls. But that will not make you a leader. That's called following. That's not called leadership. And we should not hesitate to be the first introducer of new technologies. In the old days, we used to have a tender document. Give a list of 5 people who have used it for at least 3 years. I say, I'm developing it for the first time. How can I give you a list of 5 people? So the thing happens. Technology developed here, go abroad, come back to India, by a fellow who has applied similar technologies at double the price. So we must have the mechanism for doing this. Because I have also said that very often proven technologies are a synonym for obsolete technologies. The more you prove, the more obsolete it becomes. If you are going to be satisfied with technology transfer, then you are always going to be a second-rate country, second division. You may make them, you live reasonably well. You must be, if you want to be a first ranker, you must have leadership which is willing to go for, to be the first introducer of new technology. It's a very interesting statement. Swami Vivekananda was a very far-sighted man. And he, one of the places he says, by the way, Indian Institute of Science, I don't know how many of you know, was started because of Swami Vivekananda. I don't know how many of you know this story. Many of you may know that he was traveling. J.N. Tata was traveling with Swami Vivekananda in a boat. And Tata told Swamiji, I'm going to buy technology for steel production. And Swamiji said, okay, you buy the technology. What about developing technology in the country? And that is what influenced Chidambaram Tata to start the Indian Institute of Science. In fact, you asked him to be the first director. He said, no thanks, I can only give the suggestion. You get a good scientist to head this organization. He says, he is an atheist who does not believe in himself. What a statement to make in those days. The old religion said he was an atheist who did not believe in God. So self-belief is what leads to self-confidence in technology. In fact, self-reliance should also take a more broad view of what is meant by self-reliance. Self-reliance does not mean making everything yourself. System must be yours, but the components can come from everywhere. And self-reliance I defined in those days as immunity against technology denial. If some guaranteed source is there which is gives you parts which can go into your system, why do you bother to redevelop that? But if there is anything which can be denied to you at any point of time, you must have the capability to do it yourself. This requires institutional leadership and then international collaboration. I think today's India should go for international collaboration only on an equal partner basis. Not everything, but on an average. Some you give, some you take, but on the average we should. See, when you talk about a knowledge economy and the ecosystem which is required for that, you must have excellence in basic research, you must have including what I call directed basic research, not directed by somebody, directed by India's needs. Applied research, excellence in applied research, excellence in technology development, and excellence in manufacturing. There's no point in developing all the knowledge and not able to make it yourself. That is why there is this Make in India thrust and the Startup India and all that. But here there is a snag, including for the defense sector. Right today, if you say you make an aircraft which compares to Lockheed Martin, who has been doing it for a long time, it's not going to be easy. But on the other hand, if you want to become a global leader in manufacturing in the long term, you must be willing, if necessary, to live with products with somewhat lower specifications compared to what the current global leaders can provide in the short term, as long as the indigenous products meet the critical requirements. You can't compromise on critical requirements. Very often you buy an instrument, a lot of options there which you never use. You can strip it down to what are the critical requirements. If you are able to do that, then only in the long term you can become globally competitive. This is what has happened to the Department of Atomic Energy. We imported heavy water reactor technology from Canadians, PHWR. Then there was a cutoff because of the 74 test. We got separated. And now we are in some areas, some ways ahead of them in pressurized heavy water reactor technology. Two kinds of indigenization. Progressive indigenization, suo motu indigenization, as we have to do in the case of nuclear weapons and all that. See here, you see how many of our instruments are now imported, advanced analytical, NMR, electron microscope, X-ray diffractometer. We make neutron diffractometers, but we import X-ray diffractometers. Or advanced medical, therapeutic and diagnostic instruments, because people get addicted to brand. Once you get addicted to brand, very difficult to change your mindset. See, look at this IAEA perspective on the future of nuclear energy. This was given by Yuki Amano, present Director General. And he said in Bach a couple of years back, referring to the India's three-stage nuclear power program, India is the forefront, of technological development in the nuclear sector, not least in the area of fast reactors. Dr. Baldevaraj, he was the director of the Fast Reactor Center in Kalpakkam and related fuel cycles. Fast reactor and related fuel cycles will be important for the long-term sustainability of nuclear power. That is why India from the beginning, we have gone for, take the plutonium out of the PHWRs, put it into fast breeder reactors, expose thorium there and go to the thorium uranium-233 cycle. And then he adds, I would like to conclude by noting that India's remarkable success in the field of peaceful nuclear technology is an inspiration for many developing countries. And leadership first will involve or become a leader, which is already there in a political sense, but in science and technology sense. I also appreciate India's willingness to serve as a mentor for other Asian countries that have recently joined the IAEA. See, last night I dropped in by chance into our Center for Excellence in Nanoscience and Technology. And they are holding a meeting. I asked them to prepare a slide. So the last slide, which I'll tell you, was prepared at 10 p.m. yesterday night. And I'll tell you, well, that is where to go towards leadership. See, you take international scientific cooperation. The Large Hadron Collider, which saw the signatures of the Higgs boson, by some quirk, it began to be called the God particle. The story goes that Leon Lederman, one of the scientists, he wrote an article. He had been searching for the Higgs boson. Higgs boson gives the mass to the particles which are created the Big Bang. He wrote an article, 15 years I've searched for the Higgs for this particle and I have not found it. It was a missing particle in the Standard Model. So his expression was, I was searching for this goddamned particle for 15 years. The editor said, you can't use swear words in the scientific journal. She removed the damned. So you know what happened. So that's how it became the... Now, at that time, my colleagues, I had signed this agreement. My colleagues Kapoor and Bhavalkar had said that anything the Europeans can make, we can make at half the cost. And that's what happened. Even though we contributed $40 million worth of superconducting magnets, 64 corrector magnet, dipole magnet bends the beam, the corrector magnet, 64 octopole, decapole, they focus. That's why they are called corrector magnets. And the deal is half of whatever we contributed, estimated at European costs, goes into an India fund, has gone into an India fund. And when our scientists go there, whether from atomic energy or from elsewhere, their cost is borne out of this fund that is held in Geneva. Because the worst thing in my mind is not only we go and use their facilities, we also ask them to give us TADA. That looks rather degrading. Now at least the money comes from here. Then of course we are a partner in the ITER experiment and so on. See, I must mention this. I had a conversation in Dr. Mohammad Elbaradi, who was the Director General of IAEA before Yuki Amano. And he asked me, in fact, his conversation started by him. So because I was telling him that if you are able to close the fuel cycle, take out the plutonium, put it back into fast breeder reactors, The same uranium will give you about 50 times more power. And then you put, include thorium in the fuel cycle, make it convert uranium-233 and put it back, the same uranium will give you 600 times more power. So then he asked me, can we call it renewable energy? That is going a little too far. But let us call it near renewable. We both agreed on the terminology, you're calling it near renewable. By the way, solar energy is fusion energy, as most of you know. Starts at fusion energy. By the time it reaches India, we call it solar energy. There is an interesting term by this guy, Nassim Nicholas Taleb, anti-fragile. He's the guy who introduced the term the black swan. Black swan is a totally unexpected, first bestseller was the black swan. Totally unexpected event with serious consequence. He calls, you know, if there is stress, the fragile breaks down, the robust resists. But he said there are things which become stronger on stress. Put stress, it becomes stronger. And he gives examples on evolution. Certainly, culture, Indian culture, for instance, bacterial resistance to antibiotics and so on. And he says this contradicts modern ideas of innovation. As we tend to think that innovation comes from planning or by putting through a Harvard business school class, I have deliberately omitted the next few lines. What he says there is, by a Harvard business school class given by professors who have never innovated anything in their life. So I said it's too much, so I removed that part. And he says, note the disproportionate contribution of uneducated technicians and entrepreneurs from the Industrial Revolution to the emergence of the Silicon Valley. And I feel this is also, the anti-fragility is also true of a nuclear program. The more they put controls on us, stronger the nuclear program became. Same thing is true of the space program. Fantastic, this robust polar satellite launch vehicle of ISRO. Of course, it launched the Mars orbiter very recently, and also the Astrosat launched 28 September last year, first observatory satellite. Then they have launched something with 6 satellites from some other small satellites. To date, 57 satellites from 19 countries have been successfully launched using PSLV. And 31 successful launches. See, this is how you become a leader. In the global space community, ISRO is considered now a leader. See, leaders don't become just like that. It has to be based on perceived achievements. See, advanced ultra-supercritical thermal plant, which we started, where Dr. Baldev Raj was very much involved in initiating this program, is a relatively cleaner coal-based technology. Take the steam up to 700-750. For the same amount of coal you burn, you get more power. The same amount of megawatt that you produce, you emit less carbon dioxide. So it's not a zero commission thing like nuclear or renewables, because whatever you say, next 20 years, you're going to be burning a lot of coal. If you're going to supercritical, if you go to advanced, ultra supercritical, then these are the advantages. But here is where we need India to become a leader in technology. We have to synergize. I used the term coherence energy, which I coined some time back. And this is essentially a materials problem. And then we decided, who are the best materials people in the country? Fast reactors. So IGCAR is a partner, best equipment maker, BHEL, and the best utility. And Baldev, you were the director of IGCAR at that time. That's how we got this consortium together. This is the need of the in a technology area. If you want to become a leader, we have to have consortium of complementary, exceptional capabilities. And while the big project is under discussion, we from our office, we have funded some small things like boiler tube materials. We already designed by IGCA, made by Medhani, tubes drawn by a nuclear fuel complex. And now we are looking for a test loop to be developed. Similarly, on turbine blades, superheater headers, all these small few crore projects were funded. That will be a big project when the final thing comes up. See, the fact is now, international science is getting more and more international. High energy experimental physics has always been like that. Hundreds of people you will find authoring one article. But more generally, there is an increasing global mobility of students and scientists. And according to the NSF, some years back, I'm sure numbers have gone up still then, in 20 years, from 1990 to 2010, research articles with authors from more than one country increased from 10% to 25%. I'm sure the thing is going up. Average number of authors has also gone up. So the scientific leadership in India must factor in this global chain. So that is why it requires. Now we have got, we must set up world-class facilities. Whenever we have set up a world-class research facility, it has attracted the best people, not only from within India, but also from outside. For example, next slide a little later, on this Center for Excellence in Nanoscience and Technology, which is next door to you over here. Some of you, if you have the time, if you are interested, you must go and have a look at it. And it is recognized as a world-class facility. In fact, Rudra Pratap, when he was giving a talk in Chicago, IISc alumni, he told them, look, my facility is better than yours. Those NRI scientists, and they didn't dispute it. And it has attracted people from places like Cornell or Stanford, or IMEC, Belgium, which are the top places for this. This is the one, Centers of Excellence in Nanoelectronics. Actually started after a brainstorming session in our office. So, and what we decided was, suppose we had 100 crore to spend. One way is to give established 1 crore here, 2 crore there, 3 crore there, 5 crore here. Otherwise, we say among the competent groups, choose two and give them 50 crores each, so that you create center of excellence. And but the discussion was transparent, open, and after that we decided Institute of Science, Bangalore and IIT Bombay. And we also have an Indian National Nanoelectronics Users Program. Started with 100 crores, now I think with various other fundings from others, maybe running at 500 crores. And it is open to everybody. There's an MOU between Institute of Science and IIT Bombay. 500 projects completed are ongoing under this program, 300 institutions, number of papers also, and patents. And their international collaborators are more than happy to come and see here, work here, both for Institute of Science and Bangalore. And this is the new slide that I prepared. INUP going global. And you see, because of the success of this users program, which I indicated by those quantitative parameters, the first international training program under the Indian Technical and Economic Cooperation of MEA, Ministry of External Affairs, has been launched here. And actually starting today. Today it is starting. And this is program currently underway as participants for Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Myanmar and Maldives. And in fact, more countries are interested from Africa and other places, or even from developed countries, they want to come and work here. This slide was given to me by Professor Shivashankar of the Center for Excellence. The last line I added, you should not ascribe it, that this is the way we should see global partnership. global leadership in any high technology field. Of course, you must be world class, and then it must be perceived as being world class, firstly by your neighboring countries, and then of course globally. More and more the word spreads around. And we must enhance academia-industry interaction. This has been a weakness. There is a very interesting article by Kenan Sahin of MIT. And what he said was, in this chain, research, development and delivery, academic institutions are good in research, poor in development, by and large zero in delivery, by and large. Industry is very good in delivery, poor in development, and by and large zero in research. And this is talking about United States. Two systems which are strong in their, but the middle part, development part, is the one we have to strengthen. And this being bridged to a large extent in the mission-oriented labs. Mission-oriented labs do have a program for developing it in a variety of ways. That's how we are able to build reactors or launch missiles or, see, tremendous capabilities required if you want to launch missiles with a very precise hit on the location, wherever you want to hit. And but it has to be done sector by sector. And we had, and you must have members from both advisory groups, from both the academic community and the industry community. And from my office, you've done automotive, machine tool, electronics, hardware. CSR has been doing it for a long time. University Research Park, IIT Madras, or the SIGN program of IIT Bombay. These are all things, and that is where the question of startups come up. Startups, particularly in high-tech areas. And a couple of days back, Prime Minister has simplified and a program which will help new startups. And people in the advanced labs must see how they can make use of it in high-tech startups, startups in high-tech areas. See, there is, you see, we are operating, those systems, things are changing rapidly. If you take a country like the United States, the knowledge in the academic system and the knowledge in industry, they are in thermodynamic equilibrium. Because academic is always little ahead. That is why you find, you go to Stanford or MIT and all that, a lot of industry guys hovering around waiting for new knowledge to come out and also supporting some similar research. Here very little support is in our R&D budget comes yet from, things are changing. Things are changing. Of course it is happening in a mission-oriented agency. Scientists like to be in thermodynamic equilibrium with the scientists in the developed countries. Otherwise, how do I improve my citation index? How do I improve my H index? Increase my list of publications and all that. For that, we have to be there. But Indian industry is a spectrum. In some areas, we are advanced. Some areas, we are not quite advanced. And where we are not quite advanced, it's easier for them to do technology transfer. Technology transfer, they give you technology which is yesterday's. Nobody is going to give you tomorrow's technology and allow you to compete with them. This is what has happened. They have burned their fingers in China. In the name of low-cost manufacturing, they have picked up some of the best technologies from the developed country. As India goes up and up and up, which inevitably it will do, then, as the gap closes, we become globally competitive, nobody is going to give you technology. We have to develop it ourselves. Next 10, 20 years, I see a change where academia-industry interaction will go up very, very rapidly. And we must be, the scientific leadership in India must be prepared for that time. Because as I see, already I see, a greater interest. I inaugurated the Aditya Birla Center of the, started by Kumar Mangalam Birla and all that. And many industries are interacting also. Of course, we have always nuclear and space and defense, but some areas we interacted already strongly with. In some cases, we need re-innovation. See, in the chain which I said, research, development, delivery, that was for industrial development. But for rural development, it is the delivery segment which is weak. Even though we have knowledge, it's not reaching rural areas. And under our RUTAC program, Rural Technology Action Group program, briefly referred to by Dr. Baldev Raj, we are trying to work with volunteer organizations and trying to introduce technology. And that is, and you know, interestingly in India, rural innovations go 50, 100 kilometers and they stop. Doesn't spread any further. And you can say this technology is already developed in Tamil Nadu, why not is usable in Uttarakhand? Man, the fact that rural innovation, Roy Rothwell uses it, it almost looks like incremental innovation compared to breakthrough innovation. And the China, if you read their literature, technology development, they talk about introduction, absorption, digestion, and re-innovation. This is the way they do it. They introduce technology, then they absorb it, they digest it, and then they claim. Though others don't agree, it is totally IPR issue free, but anyway. And then there is knowledge brokering. Knowledge brokering is a very interesting concept. It says, what this fellow from Harvard say, is the best innovators use old ideas as the raw materials for one new idea after another. Now, we always thought Robert Fulton and steamboat. But apparently, this idea has been in minds for 75 years before that. So, what we should do around a look at innovation, this is like a bit like re-innovation, but in a way. Now, similarly, when I went to Pune to inaugurate something, robotics conference, the R&D engineers defense lab, excellent laboratory in DRDO, they make these bridges for sappers and miners, through which foot bridges, and then there are, there's somebody from DRDO here? Huh. You are from which lab, please?
Yeah, armament.
Armament. That is your next door lab. R&D, R&D engineers. Guru Prasad. I was talking to Guru Prasad. And he said, these are very lightweight, special alloys. So, and erected from one end, they can make very long bridges through which even tanks can move. That was the time in which Uttarakhand flood had happened. I said, why don't you make bridges for the Uttarakhand cross? Because once you cut a road, or even otherwise, sometimes traveling in Uttarakhand and similar hilly areas is very tough. Why can't you make a bridge which can be erected from one end? So the logistics is restored, marooned people. He said, no problem. So, and they did it in no time. And one bridge has been erected in Dehradun in an organization, HESCO, one of the volunteer organizations. That was not cut by the floods and all that. Normally in that, you know, they have a ravine, small ravines, 10 to 15 feet in width, through which particularly the women carry loads and go in. And you can just imagine during monsoon season, when the water is flowing, how difficult it is for the dog. Just erected a bridge in no time, the Pune DRDO lab, and that is being used and that is getting multiplied over there. So one of the things, if you want to lead a chain, you must learn this knowledge brokering. What has worked in various areas and adapt it. Because without adaptation, many things don't work in the country. This is the national knowledge network. You know, connectivity today is so important for development. And we have one of the best research and education networks in the world. Almost 1,500 institutions have been built. This National Informatics Center has done a wonderful job, NIC. And the project director is R.S. Mani. And of course, I chair the committee, but the work is really done by R.S. Mani and his colleagues. I'm sure most of you use the National Knowledge Network for a variety of applications, and we are also trying to indigenize routers, and network management system has been made by a group from CDAC and by BARC and CDAC. See, application, one of the earliest applications of this was the mentoring of new IITs by the old IITs. They started the new IITs, there are no faculty. They only said IIT Madras will mentor IIT Hyderabad. How many times can a professor go from here to there? But once we had this e-classroom, the lectures given, and it's what we call a low latency network. Questions and answers just across, as though you're sitting across. And I sat with one class in Hyderabad, IIT Hyderabad, and the students told me 90% as good as hearing. But he said the professor man once in a while come and show his face. So, you know, the whole thing is not a holographic trick, you know, you have put something. Let him come and interact. But you must have a secondary teacher in that class. You have created grids. Of course, the high energy physics, what I told you about the Large Hadron Collider. TFR is a partner in this detector called the CMS, compact muon solenoid. And all the data, whenever they do an experiment with this detector, it's a consortium of universities led by TFR. All those data come directly to TFR in real time. So they have as much access to that data because of the NKN. Otherwise, you know, you have to package and send it slowly. You can't pick it up at the same speed as the EU grid. EU grid and Indian grid are connected. So within this, you can overlay it with other grids for climate change, brain research, and so on. And it's entirely up to anybody. Because when we planned and we got the support for the National Knowledge Network, it was only for the connectivity. Content is the business of the users. Anybody can use it for whatever you like. See, as I said, I introduced the term many years, coherent synergy. See, every effort has number of components. Each component effort requires synergy among the concerned parties. For example, if you want to train manpower, then you R&D labs, then universities, and we should all get together. But it should be coherent with India's needs. You provide the manpower too early, all of them go to the United States. Because you produce them too late, there's a big gap left in development. Synergy in every effort and coherence among all the efforts. One of my physicist friends asked me, synergy also has coherence. I said, yes, of course. But that is what I call local coherence. What I'm looking for is global coherence among all the efforts. Let me come to this leadership. There is a beautiful book by Stephen Covey, and one of the chapters is on seven deadly sins. And it says principle-centered leadership. Principle-centered leadership. And one of the chapters is knowledge without character. Knowledge without. See, we always know a little knowledge is a dangerous thing. We have all, and when we have also felt it in our experience. But he says, even more dangerous is much knowledge without a strong principled character. Imagine a leader without character. Of course, the way Baldev has defined it, from compassion plus, all that requires that he has character. In fact, Einstein was once asked, what is it that makes a great scientist? And his reply was, people think it is the intellect, they are wrong, it is the character. Not that anybody can do great science, but if you don't have character and integrity, you can never do great science. Starting with falsifying results, plagiarize, those are all trivial things, but in a deeper sense, without a feeling for equity and justice and so on. What he said, purely intellectual development without commensurate internal character development makes as much science as putting a high-powered sports car in the hands of a teenager who is high on drugs. Ultimately, you know, we are talking of leadership and we are talking of goals. Having said all this is also true. You cannot lay down the full specifications of a leader. This is what Andre Barwa says. The greatest quality of a leader is to be accepted as such. That is the final and the ultimate test. And you need leadership once you have defined the goal. And that goal in a democracy like India is set jointly by the people as well as as the leader. So my concluding remarks, see, India is not stoppable. Of course, I'm an optimist. What is needed now is to accelerate this growth process. And we should also have the flexibility to change tracks as we go. That is the quality of a leader. Gandhiji would suddenly call off his fast to the shock of everybody else, because he felt something was wrong. He will reverse 180 degrees. If a leader is predictable, he is not a leader. There are so many environmental activists. You tell me the issue, I'll tell you how the leader will behave. Leadership obviously needs the ability to change tracks as you go along, depending on the new situation. And to do this, you need leaders and managers, optimism, apart from self-belief and character, and of course passion. If you don't have passion, there can be no leadership. Thank you very much for...
Time for some questions, so any of you would like to ask a question, most welcome. Yes, please, there.
Speak louder, please.
So you talked about the knowledge economy, the knowledge essentially the transfer of knowledge.
Not quite, but yes, but I didn't say, okay.
Yeah, so when we say knowledge exists in the laboratories, or gets developed in the laboratories, academia, and so many institutes.
Yeah.
And before it goes into the society, as a product, as application in industries, in between there is a step called the technology. The knowledge has to be converted as a technology. The technology essentially goes into the product. So do you feel is it effective now, as of now in our country? Or if you feel it's not that effective, what's the mechanism you suggest to be effective for the industries so it can implement in a cost-effective way and a more effective way?
See, it depends on from technology to technology. Take the success stories. Nuclear, space, defense, knowledge, chemicals. You must do, you see, either you do the basic research for that, or you pick up, start from basic research, which has been done in some other country, which is getting easier and easier because of the internet. Then, you see, there is a thing called the very nice article by William Press called the Appropriability Conundrum. Their concern is basic research done in the US must be exploited into value by the United States. Because unlike the old days when Bell Labs discovered the transistor principle, they made money out of the transistor. It's not possible now, because knowledge goes very fast. So you must have the ability to convert the knowledge either generated by yourself or by anybody else through applied research. And then you must have the technology development where your marketing issue also will have to be taken into account. Just because the technology is attractive doesn't mean that the products will sell. That marketing will have to be done. It has to be something to which you must be continuously feeding in R&D-led innovation, so that you continue like Samsung or LG, you know, in these things. Just for making a thing which has got this round, Apple and Samsung, I think, had a $1 billion lawsuit. So innovations, this is what you call defensive patenting. Make sure that all that knowledge, and then you must be able to market it, you must be able to advertise, and this has been done in many cases. So for each product, one has to look at it. And the people look at it from the point of view of ease of use, from the point of view of competitive costs with respect to something alternate which you can get. You can't sell it only on the principle of made in India. Made in India is what we should be doing. Make in India using indigenous technology for the Indian market. Make in India using indigenous technology for the global market. Make in India using foreign technology also for the global market. So we should have all these components built in, and each one has to be, you see, a consumer product is different from let's say a nuclear reactor. And then you must have that ability to take risks. When you introduce the product, every product may not sell. But the companies must have, the big companies have the financial strength. But by and large, it is known that small companies are more innovative because they don't have baggage, because they don't have assembly lines which have to be reversed. So it's a very complex kind of thing which has to be done issue by issue or product by product, process by process, or even technology by technology.
So I have another small question.
Can you please restrict to one? Yes, please. Yes,
sir, when you spoke about global leadership in manufacturing, you have two terminologies about the long-term perspective and the short-term perspective. Under the long-term perspective, you said that we can afford to live with products with somewhat of lower specification.
Short-term perspective.
And long-term, you said.
No, short-term perspective, live with products which have a little lesser specifications provided. It satisfies your critical requirements.
Yes.
Only in the long term, then you can become a global leader, competing with the best in the world. That's what I said.
My question is, can we afford this type of a trade-off in terms of strategic and nuclear manufacturing?
This is what you have to decide. You have to, in very often, in strategic areas, the best product abroad is not available to you in any case. What I really meant is, suppose you are making a defense product. Very often the specifications are made out looking at the catalog of the leading fellow. And very often the DRDO is loaded with changing specifications, as not that they are not capable of delaying it themselves, well, like all of us do. But very often DRDO has this problem, that as they continue to make the product, specifications go on keeping changing. But you cannot compromise on the critical requirement. Suppose you make an aircraft, make sure that it has to hit the target with precision. And whenever there's a man and a machine together, the man can compensate for the deficiencies in the machine. But if you ask for everything to be done on day one, right in the first product, it's very, but it's the choice of the user. Nobody can enforce it. Suppose you say it is critical, then it becomes a critical requirement that I need it today, you can't make it, then I'm willing to pay for it, then you take it if you feel it is critical. But I'm saying cases where you can, you know, the old days, Avro used to be very effective because pilots were so good, old days. Against better aircraft. Now I'm saying this is not a simple formula. In fact, I've sometimes also said, India is so complex, there is no simple statement which is true for all of India. India is too complex. You'll have to paraphrase it or modify it, mutate it, depending on your exact requirements.
I am Asit Das from Reliance R&D. You mentioned in your lecture that, and all of us know that India has done remarkably well in nuclear, atomic and space research. And the main reason is the strategy. These are strategic areas where technologies were developed with a lot of effort and commitment. But same thing is not happening in energy and environment. Probably import of technology on a repeated basis is going on. So my question to you is that, is there any thought process to include energy and environment as a strategic sector for development?
See, if energy and environment you have to take for zero carbon emission. Let us take as an example, solar energy. Very clearly, the ideal thing is if you have the complete supply chain, starting with polysilicon, making the crystal, making the wafers, making the cells, making the panels and the entire chain. It is not happening. Very little investment has been gone in, except now BHEL is starting on making polysilicon. And Lanco Solar started something. You know, these are things which fluctuate. At a time, Germany had gone ballistic on solar. They took away all the polysilicon in the world market. And when Bell went and asked them, they were told, come after 3 years, we'll tell you. And the price of polysilicon had shot up. Now Germany has cooled down on solar. So the price of polysilicon is going to fluctuate. And here is where the industry, which has got enough financial muscle, must take a decision that I don't change my decisions depending on short-term fluctuations in the market. And then this becomes, and then you have to compensate for the intermittency of solar power. That means going for batteries, lithium-ion batteries, beyond that, ultra-capacitors, energy storage. So all this has to be thought of as a strategy. See, in the case of nuclear and space, right from the beginning we went for the capability of the entire fuel cycle, from mining to reprocessing and waste management. Some of the big industry groups like yours, for instance, must take a long-term view of this. And then, of course, government should do what it can change policies for this. With these, and then you look, see, for example, as a short term, companies which are interested in solar should help develop perovskite-based solar cells, though it is, the life is limited, increase the efficiency, add nanoelectronics to it, make thin films. All this we must keep thinking. It will depend on each technology. And you see, what happens is, if something is available easily to you from outside, like solar cells, then people think, why bother? But then, India is such a large country, and you cannot totally rely on availability of the front end input products, and then you go to the later end, develop technologies based on that. We must. But then, as I said, if you feel sure that this product is going to get a guaranteed supply for you, one way is to buy off the company in the abroad, which one or two come, Mozarba did something in some place, like that. Then you have an assured supply chain. Then you don't have to bother about it. Of course, there is a reason why they didn't make polysilicon, is energy costs are very high here, compared to some other countries where the energy costs are low. Though we have excellent quartz, which can be converted into polysilicon. So I'm saying it has to be done. And more people are beginning to think of it, fill gaps through startups, small startups. And big companies can advise young fellows also, which are the areas they would like to have startups. And then if you have the technology, let them do that, support them indirectly. The Americans buy them off if this becomes very successful.
Question. This was in regard to intellectual properties,
yeah,
and altruistic collaboration. Finally, I think we would all gain if knowledge is free and it is sort of everything.
Knowledge?
Knowledge. It is something which I think everybody contributes to, and intellectual property is directly against that concept. You try to protect or you try to make it an individual property, which finally doesn't lead to probably enhancement of knowledge worldwide. I just like your comments.
There are arguments for it like this. Why would a company develop intellectual property unless it has control over it? So nobody will invest. Or even countries, they invest if they have. So intellectual property right will remain, it is not going to go away, because it has got other collateral damage if you eliminate it completely. But I'm saying there are some fields, like pandemic diseases, or the climate change threat, or voluntarily somebody can do something, in which we should not focus on making money out of that. It is so important. There you require, and there the government has to fund. It will not be done by the corporate sector. Naturally, the stakeholders will ask. State companies, when they develop, they will have to retain IPR, as I see the practicality of it.
Thank you.
Is that the question you asked, or ask something different?
It is that, sir. But I would also like to just get your views on, in the future, if the knowledge protection is taken to an extent, there is a knowledge growth is impeded, sir.
See, there is an opposing stream, as you are aware of. Open data, open access, Linux software, which you do. But Linux software follow through, there is some kind of control may come. All that is also happening. People feel all data, because data science, big data science is growing in many areas, from astrophysics and biology and climate science and all that. And we are trying to bring up in a project the best practices among them together. Astrophysics guys have the best practices. Biologists have the maximum use for it. So, and to the extent that much of the scientific data is open. In fact, early days science was totally open. The moment you publish in a scientific journal, it is open knowledge. But as you go on, as making money becomes an important social habit, intellectual property became also an issue. So it is going to happen. Some areas, many areas, it will come. Patents and copyrights and intellectual property. But for example, from India, if somebody develops, I would say, why not? Make money out of it. If you have developed something clever or innovative. I'm not against intellectual property. I'm only saying India must play the game. We can't say, I want to play cricket, my rules are gilli danda. No, that's what I'm saying.
So, thank you very much. I must thank Dr. R. Chidambaram, who spoke about his experiments, experiences, and a vast wisdom. And it was always a learning experience. I'm sure, as for me, it was for you. Thank you very much for your time and communicating with the people who would make a lot of difference to this country and the world. And we adjourn now for group photograph and tea, and then assemble back here at 11:30 to listen to Dr. Sanchaiti. Thank you very much.